Okay. There's no gavel. Ouch. Welcome to the Portsmouth School Board Work Session. Today is November 17th, 2008. If I could ask the Assistant Superintendent to please take the roll call and introduce everybody as they're here.
Sure. I'm Steve Zadovic, Assistant Superintendent. Regarding attendance, Ann Walker.
Here.
Leslie Stevens.
Here.
Lisa Sweet.
Here.
Jim LaPasta, JCJ Architects.
Here.
Doug Roberts, JCJ Architects. Lisa DiStefano, DiStefano Architects.
Here.
Rebecca Emerson.
Here.
Sherry Ham Garrity.
Here.
Kent LePage.
Here.
Steve Bartlett.
Here.
Mitch Schuldman.
Here.
And John Stokel, Middle School Principal.
Here.
Thank you. Actually, I was thinking I might just start briefly with a short little history lesson, because I did this once before. Sherry?
Russ is the only one.
Oh, I'm sorry, Russ.
Can you join us up at the
table
since he is part of our meeting tonight?
Sorry.
Help yourself to wherever you feel best.
Sorry.
Thank you.
No, thank you. So I went back through the old annual reports again. I won't read the whole thing. It's actually quite an interesting letter written by the superintendent in the annual report of December 31st, 1932, which was the year that the doors to the building opened up, which was 76 years ago. And I must say, I'm curious as heck to know what was going on back then, because this is a pretty angry letter to the community about people attacking schools and not thinking that tax money is worth paying to the schools. So he titles this, it's really interesting, for tomorrow I'll just make a copy and hand it out at the meeting. He calls it our obligation, meaning, educators' obligation to educate the next generation of children. So at the last paragraph he says, it is in times of stress and crisis that human worth asserts itself best, and these present days are no exception. In spite of depression education, this was during the Great Depression, 1932, when they built our school, the greatest obligation, that is teaching our children, falling upon my generation, will continue and improve as it continues. And he says, the American people, vitally dependent upon an enlightened citizenship, will not be led astray. So maybe the newspapers can do a story on what was going on.
Where did you find it? Because
that's, it was in the annual report for 1932 from the Portsmouth School Department. And his name is Henry L. Moore. And what's interesting is we're looking at building a school building that we'd like to last 75 years into the future. And we think that 650 students is that core number we've been talking about. Well, in 1932, if you added up the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, there were 654 students. So 75 years back, 75 years forward. So we need to pick a good number. Okay. So what I'd like to do is I have, this is a follow-up from the ad hoc committee's meeting that was held, I forget when, a week or so ago. And in that meeting, which we held at the library, I shared a PowerPoint which actually walks everybody through where we are, the information about site size and cost. And so what I'd like to do is I'm handing it out. I'd like to walk through it with you. And then I have some other pieces of information, some different maps that'll be helpful. Because I think, what we're doing is we're moving toward a very short period of time. We're going to have to vote on something that's very important. But I think it's important for us to realize that the school board and the city council are, if we were trains, we're on the same track. We just are running on different timetables. We have a deadline that's due December 31st for us to put in our application that tells the state we want to build a building and this is how much money we think it's going to cost. That's what we have to do as a board so that it goes, so the application can go in. The city council has a little different task. They have to vote on the money and they don't need to do it right away, although I would urge them to do it quickly because the longer we wait, every month is another 0.5% of escalation costs, but they're on a different timetable. So we need to do our job. But the interesting thing about what we have to do as a board is when we take this vote, we each have to believe that this is the right school at the right size and at the right cost. And I say that because in the unlikely event that the city council is going to approve exactly the same number we are, if they were to do that, we would need to feel comfortable that that's enough money to do what we want the school, the city to build. So we need to believe that that's the right number. So that's really where we're moving towards, in my sense. And so that's what this work session discussion is going to be about, too. It's going to go through sort of all the information briefly that we know and why we know it and why we're, you know, as a school board, we seem to be moving in the direction of saying this and where we stand, because we're going to have to take a vote on it. So if we could just begin. Let me just see, is everything else I covered before I start that? Oh, and just a brief note on our upcoming timetable. So tonight's a work session, the 17th. Next Monday, the City Council has requested two meetings with us. Originally, we only had one, but they've requested two, so I think it's important for us to honor that. And it's just another opportunity for us to educate the community also about what we know and how we know it. Then we have a December 9th school board meeting, and my intention is, because Ann is going to be away during that school board meeting, that I want all school board members who are eligible to vote to be present at voting. So I'd like to call a special meeting for, and it depends on all of our schedules, either Monday, December, I think it's a Monday, December 22nd or 23rd, which is a Monday and a Tuesday.
I cannot do the 22nd, I can tell you right now.
Okay. So the 23rd would be the date. Well, we're going to have to pick a date and have a meeting to vote, or else, you know, we're trying to honor, you know, everyone being present, but if too many people can't do it, then we might just have to not be able to honor Ann's presence, which would be unfortunate. Now, Ann comes back on the 20th.
On the 19th.
On the 19th. And what day of the week is the 19th? That's a Friday.
Friday.
So can anyone do the 23rd? That's the night before Christmas. You got to be kidding. No way. Huh?
Two nights before. The 23rd, you said
Tuesday. Oh, did I? I meant the 24th. Because Rebecca's saying she can't do the 23rd.
No way.
Busy. All right. Well, we're going to have to work this out.
Saturday the 20th.
Ann, when do you leave?
I will send around an email with dates, and everybody, I'm going to send around an email with the dates, and everybody's going to tell me whether you can or can't do which of those days. And if everybody can make one, we'll pick that one. If not, I'll have to figure out what to do. I'll make a shared decision.
We are scheduled to potentially have superintendent interviews on the 21st,
that weekend.
So,
possibly.
1, 2, 3, 4 of us at least are scheduled to be doing something.
Okay. Well, we'll figure it out then. Okay. Not to take up any more time with this. Now I know. Thank you. Okay. So if we could start looking up. I want to start that PowerPoint up because all those slides are on here. You don't need. Oh.
You got it. We can push the button.
Sorry.
You're on your own, Jim.
No.
What happens when you're closest to it?
Okay. Well, my apologies for not planning even better. So while they're working on getting that LCD projector going, we all have copies of this PowerPoint, so I'd like to be clear as we go through this that if you have any comments, please let me know. Any major changes, if I have wrong information. But I think as we present this to the community, it's important to reiterate what we've considered to be our guiding principles as we've gone through this. I know we've all talked about this before, but I think this is an opportunity for everyone to see where we are. So we believe that Portsmouth supports Portsmouth Middle School's educational program now and into the future, that this project supports the middle school's program. It minimizes the educational impact of students during construction so that instructional time, the curriculum, and the supportive environment for all students is maintained. If they turn that on. There you go. That it provides a healthy and physical environment that is conducive to learning, that it results in a high-performance school that is environmentally sensitive and efficient to operate and maintain, that it maximizes the safety of students and staff with regards to traffic, parking, and security. It ensures optimal educational investment for the taxpayers' money, and is the result of an open process with frequent communication with educational professionals, students, and the community. So at our last meeting, we were talking about what is driving the size of where we are with the middle school, and it comes down to actually three things: that the team concept drives the student range and how many students we're building that will be housed in the school, that demographics drives the core size number that we're looking at is building to the core, the community spaces of 650, and that the program, which in our eyes is really nothing more or less than the current middle school curriculum, drives the size of the building. So this is a very complicated picture, but if, you know, we're giving this to you and the city council, and the people are going to be able to study it over the course of a weekend. This is the team concept. This is where all of these this information and numbers comes from, and that sixth grade has each team has four core classrooms: math, science, social studies, and English. Science is off on the right because they're a little different. And each of those classrooms, we're figuring 24 to 27 students. It could be 22 students, it could be 21 students, it could be 26 students, but that's what is in our teacher's contract, is what we, the board, believes in our negotiations with them, that that's the optimal class size, 24 to 27 students. So you go through all those core classes in the sixth grade, in the seventh grade, and you add those numbers up. There's two tracks, one at 24 students, one at 27 students, and you add it all the way down, and you see that that's where the 636 to 696 comes from.
Lisa. Is it possible to label those bars?
I had them labeled, and I took it out.
Okay.
Because that's a lot of information on there already, and I thought even more. But I can put them back if you'd like. Well, meaning English, math, science.
Yeah. It seems like it would be more clear, but you looked at it, so whatever.
Okay, I can put it back. Because the science part's interesting, because the science classrooms cannot have any more than 24 students. Mm-hmm. No matter if the other classes are 30 students, the science lab can only have 24.
So is each blue bar 12 students?
No.
12 to 25.
Each blue bar is just a class of a classroom: English, math, science, social studies. English, math, science, social studies, language arts in the seventh and eighth grade.
I've always wondered.
I mean, if it's too confusing, I can take those pictures out of it. Sorry.
I think it's good. But I do wonder, what happens if you have a kind of a group that moves around in a 25 or 26 or whatever, and then they go to science? What happens? Who doesn't get to go to science? How does that work?
Say, for example, the seventh grade right now.
Very good.
With the enrollment, we've been fortunate that we've been able to keep those classes at 24 or under.
Because that's true for high school as well. It's a safety thing for science classrooms. I understand that, but
and that's a state regulation of 24, no more than 24 students in a science lab.
Right. I just always wondered what happens if.
So it works out.
It seems to work out.
Yeah. So this next picture really just gives people a sense of, again, we're looking at grades. I think John, I think those numbers, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade student enrollments, may not be right. I think that adds up to more than 540, but
we should maybe be 543 as of today.
So maybe you could just help me with that at some point. So really, this is the same team concept, sixth grade. Well, no, don't think of it in terms of classrooms. This is class size across the top. So if 24 students are in the class, you go down through it, you get 636, 696. It's just another way to show that the team concept is what's driving the range. Because if we had 22 students, or say 20 students in every classroom with a population of 532, which is close to where we are, we'd still have the team concept. We'd still need the exact same number of classrooms that we're asking for as we build this building. So this is just a way to show those numbers. Yes?
How did, when you first put the middle school concept into practice, did you come up with the two teams per grade as opposed to four?
Actually, originally there were four teams per grade.
Okay.
When we first started teams back in the late 70s, we were just seventh and eighth grade, and at that time we were over 1,000 students in just 7th and 8th grade. That's when Pease, of course, was here, and at that time, Mariners Village had around 700 rentals with a family, I think, in every rental. So at that time, we had actually had four teams in the 7th grade and four teams in the 8th grade. And as populations dropped, we went to three teams per grade level and then started looking at the possibility of a 6, 7, 8 middle school concept. And we had made that decision, the board had in 1990, and then to our surprise, the base closed, which actually made the numbers even more comfortable because it would have been pretty tight with the base still here. At that time, I had 179 seventh and eighth graders just from Pease. So when Pease closed and those students all left within 1 year, it made it more comfortable for the sixth grade to move and move even more towards the middle school concept.
So what's your comfort level for a team? Is it 100 students in a team or?
The beauty about the teams would be that the team can range anywhere from 85, and right now our seventh grade is 209 students, so you're talking around 105 per team. I wouldn't want to see us go much over 110 in order to honor our class sizes.
Right.
Now, you may find some schools where they have 125 students on a team, but they're really pushing the limits on those class sizes when you do that.
Okay.
Sorry, Kent. Yes.
I think there should be a note in regards to this that on the previous slide, the range of students 636, that we did change. I remember the meeting well, John. What year was it? 90? It was 93. I'm trying to think because Nicole was in the first group that did sixth grade.
I 91.
Think 91. So I think there should be a footnote where the sixth grade is introduced back into the middle school at that
time.
In 91. Mm-hmm. I don't think you have to go back. I think there is relevance to looking at the history of being a junior high in the 30s, the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, and then moving more towards a conceptual middle school. And when the sixth grade came in, that allowed you to really meet middle school concept, because that's more standard than others. I know there's some with 5th through 8th, and I know there's still some 7-8.
Yeah.
But I think that we show that that's better utilization of that building that allowed us to do the right things in the elementary school. It's a domino effect, and I think if you don't note that it doesn't allow discussion, or it may end discussion of people that have said, well, why, if you have this building capacity, why don't you just go 7th and 8th? Well, we know, as the voted electric for the elementary level, we don't want to put the 6th grade back there. And there's still people out there that have had that discussion. There's no room, and it's not the concept, nor is it the voted educational narrative that we want to go with. So I think it's a very important thing to say. We like 6th, 7th, and 8th because of its educational outcome, and it's done well since 91. I couldn't remember what year it was.
And it's actually the piece that has made the difference.
And it took a transition period.
That third year.
So 91 was the year the 6th grade was moved into the building.
Correct.
So you could actually start doing the middle school concept. Mm-hmm.
Before that, we had teams, but they were not what I would call true teaching teams.
Right. They were cohorts.
It's when that third year moved in.
Right.
That it didn't allow you that progression of education that is vital in the middle school
concept. Lisa?
I'm looking at this slide,
yeah.
And it has a lot of information on it. I'm wondering if one thing I would like to highlight, I can't remember if it's highlighted somewhere else,
okay.
Is our current class sizes, because
that's what those, it's funny, you know, I'm trying to do a lot.
I know
that's what those yellow bars are.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
that's about where current sizes
see. Okay.
Okay.
So but I think what's important about our current
so I need a footnote
sizes.
And a legend. Thank you.
But what I think is important about that is that you can see that from, you know, 1 year to the next, our class size can vary by 50 students.
Quite a bit.
And we have to accommodate that swing from year to year?
Go to the next slide, and it'll talk exactly what you're talking about.
So, and then I wondered if we needed the column of 15 and the column of 30 class size.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
You don't think we need that?
Well, I don't know. I defer to what you think because you've been working on it, but it seems like...
Too much. It fills up the 30. Page with too much information.
30 is more than we would have, and 15 is, you know, I mean, the sixth grade is a very small class, and that's below that size.
Right.
You know, the eighth grade is about average. And the seventh grade is huge. I think that's correct.
No problem.
Okay. And these numbers do add up to 560.
Which one? Yeah, 560. That's what I mean. Yeah. So we have to get the
543.
Right numbers. We'll have to get the right numbers. Okay, the reason I said the next slide, Lisa, would help answer saying what you're saying is because this is the demographics of the next few years. These are based on real numbers as best as I could get at the moment when I filled in this graph. Table rather, for the next 5 years going back to kindergarten as they move through the elementary school. So 524, so there's that dip. What is that? That's about those 50 student dip that you're talking about. Okay. And then in 5 years out, we're up to pretty close to, and it's very hard to predict where we are today, a little less, but.
Right, but I think that even on the slide before, what you see is how the sixth grade varies from the seventh grade, which varies from the eighth grade.
Correct.
And so that team space has to accommodate that flexibility. You know, it has to be able to reign, you know.
Yeah, it has to be able to adapt.
And I think when you see it as the whole student population, you might miss a little bit on that where, you know, we can't say, sorry, our seventh grade is full. Could you go to sixth grade or eighth grade because those have more room? You know, we have to be able to accommodate everyone that needs to learn here.
Right.
So.
And these are our kids who are here presently now.
These are our kids coming up through the system.
Yeah.
So on the next, so really I think, you know, part of it is we've had a big discussion, thank you, Steve, about this issue of demographics. And I think after the whole thing is said and done, we, at least I come away with this understanding that some have suggested that there's declining enrollment coming, and others have suggested that there's growth in student enrollment coming. But I think the thing that, you know, really resonates with me more is that when we had Dr. Gattell here, you know, experts are suggesting, A, that the numbers should only be used as a baseline starting understanding and not as truth in and of itself, and that especially the low numbers predictions we've heard were really dependent upon policies of the city council in terms of how they handle issues of housing. You know, so the first thing that I want to look at, just to show that there's some information out there that talks about the demographic graphic growth. So the first one is the Carsey Institute report, which talks about New Hampshire is gaining migrants at every age group, and gains are greatest for household family age households. Population gains were greatest among age groups likely to include parent-child households. So here's one indication of a trend in the future where migrants from out of state are moving in from who knows where, probably Connecticut, Massachusetts, or wherever. And they happen to be of the age of families that have children. Next. So the next one is, I think this might be the right one, the U.S. Census Bureau,
Energy.
Yeah, this is okay. I think it's actually, pardon me, hang on one second, I'll tell you, 14.8%. Yeah, go to the next page. It's the next page. Thank you. Yeah. This is the U.S. Census Bureau, which is showing some numbers here that even though New Hampshire may be graying, school age population is still expected to grow, and it's very hard to read on there. But they're projecting by the year 2030 an 14.8% increase in children and people under the age of 18 by 2030. So here's some projections that suggest that there is population growth. You can go back one slide. And the last one, this last one here is from the New Hampshire Office of Energy and Planning, which looks at various municipal population projects, shows this is Rockingham County, and basically shows that the full page, I've just pulled a little piece out here on the PowerPoint, but I have in the packet, you'll get the absolute full page, projects Rockingham County population increase of 18.5% by 2030, and Portsmouth, the population of Portsmouth to increase by 16.1% by the year 2030. So the point of all this really is that there are some people who suggest that we'll have a smaller growth of enrollment and other people who suggest we will have a larger growth in the student population. And it just seems to me that it makes more sense to build for the bigger projection than to build a middle school for 300 students. So, okay. And then the last part, which you could help me fill in here if you want, is as we look for the in the demographics in the future, Portsmouth is always going to be a highly desirable place to live. We've said that many times, as have many people who live here and visit here. And Portsmouth recently, once again, makes another list, was recently recognized as the 6th most historical city in the U.S. and the 28th most historical city in the world by National Geographic Traveler magazine. So that's enough to get people to want to think about moving to Portsmouth. Kent?
Just the salesman comes out of me. That's 6 slides on demographics. It's a kill. You got to... I think you got to try to combine it somehow. You won't get off of one subject with the way the city council or somebody's going to ask. I think if you can combine at least one, if not two, get it down to.
Well, I could actually just keep the one slide up like this, and you know this, which is actually these other pages.
Right.
This is just backup information. So
the backup information. I think any subject that, as you go through. When president presenting, I learned throughout my years with FedEx that one slide, maybe two slides, is the way you hit it with the most information. If you have the other information to give out, that's fine. Otherwise, more questions are cultivated than needed.
Okay. Oh, that's a good point. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. Are people in agreement with that? We'll make less slides and actually hand out the information, and they can look at. Okay. All that great graphic design right out there.
What fun you had doing it.
Well, this is how I think, actually.
I know, so there you go.
I don't mind throwing it out. Okay, so, and then we get to, well, go back one slide. So does anyone have anything else to say about how wonderful Portsmouth is?
Well, Portsmouth is wonderful. One thought I had is that I don't know if there's any change in the amount of public housing we have, increase or decrease. But if it remains the same, a lot of people who live in public housing have children.
Right.
So that won't change. You know, there's an argument of the graying of New Hampshire, but we have a 50% rental.
Rent.
I think in Portsmouth. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
52, actually.
So you want that up as a statistic?
Well, I think that's significant that we have half of the housing that we have.
50% is rental property.
Is rental property.
Okay. Well, we also know that I don't know the statistic, although I've heard city councilors say it to me, you know, that, you know, there's only about 18% of families in Portsmouth have children who go to the schools.
But let me counter that there are two things, as Leslie brought up. There is a large building area that is always under consideration, and as the economy recovers in the south end of the town towards Rye, that, you know, the planning board has had plans on it, people have discussed it, so there is potential for
growth
for better than 300 dwellings, and we'll call it that. That's pretty much the townhouse type situations. The other thing is, there's a flip side to this gray side, and it's a morbid thing to bring up, and I apologize. The gray side in 10, 12 years starts to be a non-gray side because they either move or die. And, you know, it's a fact of life. As those people die, and I've seen it right on my neighborhood, I had a lady that was 100. I had people in their 70s, 80s, and 90s. They have passed away. And what has moved in? Young couples, either with one child or no children, but planning children. And that's why census and everything is a gamble. So going to Lisa's statement there, I think there is that there's a counter to the graying side. Mm-hmm. Who's filling these houses as that population moves on to greener pastures.
There's also the
true. Absolutely.
Nicely said. There's also the Atlantic Heights development they were talking about.
There's
which,
a number
which
of
was
things.
Low income or lower priced condominiums that were designed for families. So
okay. Wow.
And if Newington ever does anything, we can't forget Newington still has the highest amount of potential growth in the Seacoast.
Program. So this is just a very quick summary of a comparison. You're all going to get in your packet, you know many of this information. Actually, you know all this information already. With more detail from the ed specs that's online that the administration filled out already, which actually walked us through every one of these main areas and talked about the existing square footage, the proposed square footage, justification for the proposed square footage, the New Hampshire State requirements, and so I've just kind of summarized it here. And I think just the point is, you know, we're at 131,655, or is that 665? I forget. 665. And really, what we're only asking for after 77 years is a building that's 33% larger than what's there now, which I think, which to me is a reasonable sense of growth. Yes?
I have a question. It's probably for Mr. Stokel. That you indicated before that we can get waivers for approximately 115,000 square feet. It's things that the state doesn't require, but it's things that we think are important in our program.
I believe, as a minimum, I believe.
Well, I was just wondering what that other 16,000 square feet is comprised of.
Oh, and in our proposal, that's where we will explain the Unified Arts program in depth, where we have two family and consumer science classrooms, two tech ed classrooms.
Right, and those are things that before you had indicated the state will allow an additional 14,000 square feet in waivers?
That's not in the 115.
Okay, that's in that extra.
That's between the 115 and the 131.
And, okay.
Could I ask Stephen to, I'll, you know what? What do I do? Just that? Mr. Technology.
Let you go ahead.
These are rough estimates, Rebecca.
So this is that above the 115?
Yeah, I just made, this is just my guesstimates. For example, you know, the state wants a classroom for visual arts and tech ed at 1,400 square feet and consumer science. I think visual arts might be 1,200, I forget, but this is just a rough estimate. And then the performing arts, we're asking for a 4,000 square foot space, which we'd have to ask for a waiver. And then there's the 1,000 square foot each per grade for the common team space. So just a rough kind of addition. That's 11,200 square feet. So the rest of it is probably just smaller little additional spaces in, you know, administration and all that.
Okay.
And so when we get to this, there's also the calculation of if we get waivers for this, how much, you know, in terms of reimbursement, how much more we might be.
And it's likely that the state will say, yes, visual arts is important, you can have it. I mean,
this is the extra room that above the state saying, you know, you should have one if you have a program. And for 15 years, Portsmouth has had two, for, you know,
right.
So we're asking for just what we have, not for anything more. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so that's what this slide's all about. 33%, to me that's reasonable, yes.
Is there a reason that the numbers at the bottom don't line up?
Yeah, it's a Mac to a PC issue. You know, I just loaded this up on the.
Okay, well, so they will line up, though?
Would I bet my life on it? No. But I'll do my best.
Okay.
Speaking from experience, you'll have to edit it on the PC if you want it to stay that way.
I think you're right.
We have that problem at the office. Graphics is on Macs, we're on PCs. We do the final edits on our PCs.
Oh, I hate that. That hurts.
Sorry.
yes.
Just a question now.
Sure.
And I attended the other week a little bit listening to the group, and I'll discuss at the end some of my concerns.
Okay.
But I do see, and the one thing I take positive out of the discussion you had last week in the subgroup is you did talk finally, and it was more than the sheet of paper that keeps coming back about the cuts that you've made.
Next page.
But what I'm saying is here, where you get to the right size, column-wise, especially as I think John pointed out that night, special ed taking a fairly significant cut. I think if you put in square footage the cuts beside here, you started at, I mean, we all know we started at 180, 156, and we get down to this miracle number of 131,655. Is that something showing those cuts
in
and
sped.
That there has been. Otherwise, you get into the discussion of, where can you make more cuts? You've already gone through John's cuts, and to be able to demonstrate that you're not asking for more. I mean, I may not agree, and I totally don't agree with the price, but you're not, you are already undercutting, I think, size. And John and I have had this discussion. There is no more size in the building to cut. And he's drawn the line in the sand.
Yeah, but my question is, what you're saying is missing from this slide is some indication that there's been a substantial cutback in SPED.
Well, SPED, and I think there were a few other things that you mentioned beyond the dang kitchenettes for the auditorium.
Right.
And again, I think there was something else, John, you brought up other than special ed that night.
Things that we've given up, you mean?
In the process.
There's a whole list. We had a whole list of them.
Well, but the other night, that night, they did a nice rundown. Actually, John knew pretty much what it was. And I think put those in a parenthesis that you cut from the original size.
Mm-hmm. I can't remember.
Is that the one at Pass?
Yes.
Then that's on tape.
No, I'm sorry, not at Pass. It was the work session you had last 2 weeks.
This was at the library.
You made mention of it, and you kind of knew square footages that night.
Well, so let me just run through this, and then, we can see, because I hear what Ken's saying, so maybe it's in here, and maybe it needs to be brought out in a different way, or maybe I need to add it. So that would be the question. And then,
And I understand that not everything is going to be on a slide, and a lot of it's going to be.
Yeah, look how much is on there already.
Narrative. But I think it's really important to emphasize that we are not adding any classrooms to the building.
We're not asking for anything more than we already have. Just
this is what we already have code. And I think following along with what Kent was asking for, we wanted to have an auditorium for our performing arts program.
Right.
We cut that.
Right.
And we got it to the point where, we asked for more cuts and, got it down to the point where, well, all we can do now is give it a haircut, that kind of cut. And we can't cut any further without cutting the program. So, okay. There is no way that we can go back. We need to somehow tell that story as well. And I think that's what you're asking for.
Rebecca.
I think maybe another way to sort of flesh it out is to start with the minimum and build up. And so instead of looking at it as cutting and cutting and cutting and cutting, saying this is what the state recommends. This is the minimum of what the state, you have to have so many square feet for a health office. You have to have so many square feet for guidance. You have to have an English class, so on and so forth. And then say, but we also offer French and Spanish above and beyond, and build up instead of cutting, because it is easy. Well, we've already cut it down from 154. Why can't we keep cutting it anymore? And I think if we are building up and adding up, it's like during the budget presentation, we said if we give the budget maker 3% more, what will you do with it? If we gave you 5% more, what would you do with it? And it's a building up instead of a whittling away.
I understand that.
So look at it as a more positive instead of.
Well, see, the only thing I have that I would disagree with that is that that assumes that what the state is saying is what we need.
There's more.
The state is only saying what they're willing to pay. It has nothing to do with, necessarily
right,
a quality
education.
Right,
but isn't that part of the discussion is what we offer above and beyond, and we want to keep offering what we offer, and this is why it's coming out as large as it is. I mean, I think people are still having a really difficult time grasping
See, I think the next slide will answer this question, because I do not believe that this is large, period.
Right, and we need to explain why.
And I'll show you in a second. But let me just walk through this quickly so you get a clear sense of what it is. So this is everything that, from the initial architectural suggestions of what we had talked about, what they had discovered through talking to teachers, the wants, the would likes, that kind of thing. So we started at that number, which was larger, and then we had the conversation amongst ourselves and the community, who said to us that they thought that 155,000 square feet was large, 180 was huge. So we've made some sacrifices. We've made some compromises. That's what it's all about, right? So we've eliminated 3 conference rooms. The teacher collaboration room is now going to double as a conference space. We've eliminated one whole common team space from each grade. So that's a total of 3,000 square feet right there. We've combined the daily living center with the classroom and the SPED program, the phys ed program, combined team rooms with locker rooms, and we got rid of the weight room and replaced it with a health classroom. Eliminated the auditorium. We replaced it with a stage and bleachers in the student commons. We've reduced the size of the band room. Combined the choral room with the stage, which is really a creative way to help make that common space more of a stagey auditorium, cafetorium type thing, and also use it as a rehearsal space for the music program. We've eliminated one music classroom totally, combined that with tech studio and general music, and we deleted ensemble rooms and reduced the number of practice rooms for the students to play in. We got rid of the kitchen, added a kitchenette. We deleted one visual arts classroom, combined two together. We had asked for three. We have two now. Now we're asking just for two. We had originally asked for a computer lab in the Media Library Center. We cut that out. And the architects, in their haircut, cut the wall and circulation space from 40% to 37%. So that's, unless I've forgotten some other things, and Kent, if you could, as if it comes to you later, you could, you know, sort of throw in.
And I just think you put in parentheses on that slide previous the square footages that are negative in parentheses.
Oh, that's what you're saying.
Yeah, you just put them in parentheses so that, and John kind of had some of the numbers the other night, and I'm sure they're easy enough to say what, especially in the special ed, I think,
okay.
John, and there were, I think, language lab or language labs or whatever it was. There were three things that were pointed out.
Yeah, there's some negatives here. There's foreign language, negative, media center, negative, health suite, negative, but we should look at SPED.
This is
okay. Rebecca.
That's still all taking away.
Okay, hang on. Yes, I know. I mean, I don't... Yes, it is taking away from where we started as opposed to building up from 101.
Right. I mean, I just see, like, we could have, you know, a million square foot building as our ideal dream, and we could take away and take away and take away and take away. And we need to explain, well, what's left and why we will not cut any more of what's left.
Well, we will not cut any more.
And we need to...
I think we have a justification for... You know, in the information that John is giving, you're asking me to turn it around.
I'm just
make an argument for building up.
Right.
Yeah.
And then I can see, well, the reason that we have two more classrooms is because we offer French and Spanish, which the state doesn't say that we require. Other middle schools don't offer. You know, you keep talking about the program, and I want to know the good, the positive,
good. So,
the add up to the program.
So my suggestion is, I agree with you 100%. And in short of having time to redesign this and make that slide, I mean, we're having a joint work session with the City Council, and I would encourage you to help make that point, bring that up again, you know, because I think we're looking at it both ways. You're building up and starting from a point and saying this is what we would like to have had, but this is what we cut. Anne.
I think the mentality of our colleagues and of our community is that we need to be cutting as much as possible, and we have done that over and over and over. And I feel, as all of you do, I have cut as much as I'm willing to cut. I am not willing to cut one inch more. That we have cut as much as we can and still do our programs and do justice to our kids. So I think we need to absolutely refer to it your way, but I think we need to indicate we've already done the cutting.
Okay. So when I say it's, you know, this is not a big building, this slide really just sort of lays out middle school building size comparisons. These are schools that have been built in middle schools that have been built in New Hampshire over the last 5 years. I think we've talked about this enough, but I'll mention it again. If we look at some of the numbers under capacity of students, so the square footage is really to say this school is really not that much bigger than any other school that's been built in the last 5 years for middle school. 131, 131, 125, 118, and we're asking for 131, 665. This is not a huge, big school. This is just the right size, given what hopefully people would be willing to pay.
Just one caution on it.
Absolutely.
Is that, you know, and I know we're, and I believe Kearsarge, I know we're for a fact is 5th through 6th, which again, you have a little bit programming differences on that, and that, you know, if you're trying to compare apples to apples,
where is middle school? Is just 5th and 6th grade?
5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. It is 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. So it has a whole other grade to it.
Four grades.
I believe, Kearsarge
Okay.
Maybe, I can't remember, and I don't know, but I think that, you know, truth in lending, you want to make sure people realize that some of these are fifth through sixth. And I really think it probably relevant because it's still one of the newest ones out of here. Where is probably there is also the Bedford School, which is only 2 years old, I believe. Bedford Middle School, he's 2 or 3 years old now, is an example that should be there. And I don't know whether that's fifth through eighth.
Anybody want to volunteer to do the homework? Get back to me.
I have it somewhere.
But you'll send it to me?
Yep.
Okay.
I may have it here.
You may have it here.
Okay. Mitch, I think to get back to Rebecca's point a little bit, I think we need to just keep saying we're not asking for anything above and beyond what we already have. That we, what we're asking for is what, but I think we just need to keep reiterating that, and that we're not asking for putting new programs in, and that the state has said to us,
state standards.
Well, the state has said to us, we're not asking you to take things out. You know, they don't want us to remove things from our program.
No, they don't want
us. We're focusing on what we've taken away instead of focusing on what we have.
And that our the school, this school supports our program.
Yeah, but I also think, I agree with Antis, it's important to, I agree with you as well. Yeah, I absolutely do. I hear what you're saying. But I think it's important for the community to realize that we're listening. You know, we don't have all the answers. We're talking and we're cutting. And we have them.
But I think Rebecca's argument, you know, kind of says no matter how you look at it, this is the right number.
Right.
Right.
I mean, you can look at it right top down or bottom up.
Thank you. Okay, so moving along. Now, I don't know if I don't want to put JCJ on the spot, but do you have some cost information, too, for tonight? Anything new? I'm just asking.
Yeah, and what's on your slide? No.
Okay, perfect. This is what I try. I just want to include you in the conversation.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
Make sure you're listening.
This is my understanding of where we are with the cost. So, the number right now is 44,808. And I just felt it was important to break it out a little differently than JCJ has been doing for us, because people keep saying, well, but what is the cost of building the building? And then there's other costs, you know. So in my mind, you know, I can't view it any other way. This is a middle school project. Call it what you want. You know, there's a lot of things in here we have to answer to, parking and fields and eminent domain, you know. But that's how I'm viewing this. This is the package. So basically, the building construction costs, the site development cost, which in that top column of $30.9 million to build the building, I've taken out the fields, just pulled it out of that calculation, because it's really not the building. It's site development to build the fields. And I put that on the bottom. So just to build the building, so site development on the current site and O'Leary and the field, and then the contingencies that are built in and the escalation costs that are built in. So based on their budget to us, adding up all those, it's about $31 million to build the building. And then there are all these other costs that contribute to the 44,800. Yes, Lisa.
Can you say that field thing over again? Because I'm confused. Well, it's up there as two fields and then down. Look.
No, it's not up there, actually. That's okay. A mistake. Thank you.
Okay.
What I was saying is I took the two fields out of there, but I neglected to take the words away.
Okay.
Because that $1.9 million would have had 2.25 added to it.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Good catch.
So
basically, we're talking about $2.25 million for fields. We have $3.2 million, which is a calculation per student for what we think we're going to, it's hard to predict, for technology and telephones and furnishings in the building. Project development, which is architectural fees, construction management fees, and some of those other fees that JCJ lists on their long budget sheet for us. The cost of purchasing the deed restriction, of lifting the deed restriction, which is an estimate we don't know. It's $2 million. And then owner contingencies that are built in on top of that, unforeseen issues. And I just want to say about the eminent domain, you know, this is thinking ahead. So let's just say we, as a board, vote that this is what we want to build, 44,800. Let's just say we decide that. An eminent domain, which might come in 6 or 9 months, is not going to cost $2 million. It's only going to cost $1 million. I think we should build into the motion that we vote on that the final number reflect the difference if it goes down? If it goes up, then all bets are off, probably. So that's just my sense. Yes.
Can we indicate, you know, with an asterisk or something, the numbers like site acquisition, and doesn't Fields have a big question mark with it?
Well, there is a big question mark with that. The unknown of the infrastructure.
Right. So wherever, you know, we don't know the numbers, maybe we should just indicate it, that it's a sort of a softer number than some of the other ones.
Well, those are hard numbers. I mean,
but they could go up.
Could go
up. I mean,
up.
Depending on where those fields are located, yeah. That could go up.
Yeah. I feel for the JBC. It's going to be hard work. So let's see. So that's the $44 million. That's our package. You know, if the city council votes for that, then we're good to go, and we'll have a middle school next week. So basically, just going through now, this is the state reimbursement. So as we get to the money, so we look at reimbursement, people understand where we're coming from. We're talking about a student corps of 650. So the state considers that 90% utilization. So if we were to be 100% utilization, according to their calculation, we'd be at 722, and they will pay us $140, reimburse us, I should say, at 140 square feet per student, no money, sorry. And that's 101, that's the 101, Rebecca, you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
That's where that starts.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've applied, but they've had conversations with the state, and there has been preliminary approval based on the programs that we offer here for all of those listed, adding up to an additional 14,565,000 square feet, which takes us to 115,645. So if we look at the next, so that's what our reimbursement is based on right now for construction. So this is the reimbursement part. And I know Dr. Lister's not here, but he'll be here. I just need to say this because we had a conversation. He was in Concord the other day and was at a meeting with other superintendents and the commissioner. And there was talk in that room that the state may be looking at, you know, a potential 3-year moratorium on state building aid for building schools throughout New Hampshire. Now, I don't know, that's not in effect, there's nothing about a date, there's nothing, but it's talk. And so right now, we're going on the assumption that there is state aid. We want to get our application in on time to be eligible for the state reimbursement. And this is where the reimbursement numbers come from. 43% is what we're eligible for, 30% among, as a, just by the mere fact that we exist, Portsmouth is great, 30% reimbursement. The fact that we have middle school students from Newington here, it makes us eligible for another 10%, which I believe in my conversations with the superintendent and the other SAU, all agreements will be ready and signed in time for the application to go forward in terms of area understanding, area agreements, and the Newington agreement. So 10% for Newington, and then because we're applying to be a, what's it called?
High performance
school, thank you. We're eligible for an extra 3%. So that's where that number comes from. So 43% of site development, 43% of building development, which is a calculation by the state, at 115,000 square feet, where they've given us waivers for, times 43%, and that number times the state's set construction rate of $180 per square foot, and that equals $8.9 million. That would be part of the reimbursement package. And then project development costs, which are architectural fees, construction fees, we're eligible for 43% of that, and all other costs, contingencies and stuff. So the taxpayers of Portsmouth are eligible for a total reimbursement of $14.8 million. So that means the actual cost to the taxpayer as it stands right now is $29.9 million if we move forward and the city council bonds the complete 44.8. That's where that reimbursement, that's where that cost is. And just on the next page, we went and we talked about some of the likely waivers. So the assumption is we're making a strong case. We're going to, I mean, I absolutely feel confident based on nothing that we're going to get it because we deserve it. We have a great unified arts program. And if that's the case, this extra 11,200 square feet is an additional $866,000 in reimbursement. So, and I think it's important to understand, because I know John Bohenkel's explained it to us a couple times, that the reimbursement comes once a year. It's like a big present. You know, we're bonding X. We're supposed to pay this much money, and the state every year goes, okay, here's 43% of that.
So adding the 11,200 to the 115,645 square feet.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
I would like to see that up there, that the state says, okay, 126,845, 845 square feet. And that is much closer to 131.
And it could be all. Who knows?
It could be all. But I think that that's good if we see that that way we're only 5,000 square feet instead of 16.
I agree. Okay. So just moving on. Oh, the other thing I need, this is a work session, so, and this would be from JCJ at some point, the actual other required waivers from the state. I forget exactly what they are. So I have a little list of things there. And I also, you know, when we get to the fields, because that's going to be, if we move in a certain direction and make a recommendation, that might require a waiver as well for artificial turf. Actually, that might require a double waiver, but I'll explain that when we get there. Okay. And I think it's important for people to understand, too, that this has been a long process, and as we stand right now, you know, we're looking at Parrot Avenue, renovating and expanding the middle school on Parrot Avenue, and that there are certain costs inherent to that decision that the community has talked about, the city council has even talked about, and we have talked about staying on Parrot Avenue. One is the cost, these are costs we wouldn't necessarily have if we went somewhere else. We wouldn't have to demolish any building. We wouldn't have to necessarily put any pile foundations in. We wouldn't have to take out any asbestos. We wouldn't have any phasing, which adds anywhere from $1 to $2 million over the term of the process. Okay, and then the cost of eminent domain. I mean, if we built new somewhere else, we wouldn't have phasing. But if we didn't do phasing, we'd have to purchase temporary classrooms, and that would be probably a comparable expense. Ken, did you have any hand?
Yeah, under the asbestos. There should be an additional $15,000 because you have the asbestos abatement consultant.
Yeah, I think I rounded. You're right.
You know,
I'm again, rounding.
Truth in lending. I just always want to make that. And asbestos was one of the few things when we did the high school that was an overrun. I mean, we had many things that were an underrun because, as anybody knows, we came in under budget under the high school. But I think Ann can remember the one thing that we went over on because there were axillary charges because we did it during the school breaks at times. It was the only time we could do it. So it actually escalated and you're going to have the same situation. And I highly recommend, if we keep going the path of renovating this building, you give Amesbury a call and see how delightful they were during their renovation period on this and their overruns. And asbestos is just gone. Many things have gone down in construction, and I'll talk about that. But asbestos, it's getting tougher to get rid of.
It's getting more expensive, is what you're saying.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Thank you. These are costs that are above and beyond by the mere fact that we're asking people, the people are asking to have the middle school stay downtown. Some people. And this is just some information about the history of the size and the cost that where we've come, I know, Rebecca, I apologize to you, where we've come from and how we've come down from that number. What I did was I asked JCJ to help me with some of these numbers on the side here, which was, if you were to look at the budget that they've given us and all the expenses and costs that are on their actual budget, and then looked at the earlier size cost budgets that they presented to us over time and then added in the other costs that we now know that we didn't know at that time that were listed as to be determined, those are the figures roughly that the schools would have cost. So the initial 155,000 square foot almost would have cost $64 million had we actually gone forward and built that with the auditorium. And then when we came down to 138, 134, and then, you know, here we are. The other part that's important on there is that if you guys, sorry, JCJ, Jim, I don't mean to call you by the name of your firm.
Oh, that's okay.
It's very rude.
When you say that, I can defer to Doug. And it's okay.
If you could sort of help us a little bit, maybe you could talk about the, you know, your cost of construction, because initially those numbers were based on a higher rate, and then over time you've talked to people and come down to a different rate. So could you help us with that a little bit?
Sure. Happy to. Do you want to do it right now?
Sure.
Okay. Again, when we first started this process, we reached out to a national construction management firm that we are familiar with that has public school experience, work experience, and they helped us with square foot costs, unit costs to use for the budget models. As we got further into the process, we wanted to expand that discussion to reach out to New Hampshire-based construction management firms that are also have a wealth of public school experience. And it's through that dialogue that we arrived at the initial dialogue was $210 a square foot for new construction costs, $165 a square foot for renovation. When we expanded the dialogue to be more New Hampshire-centric, the numbers came down to 185 and 140. And again, the discussion, we had numbers for new construction that ranged as low as $135 a square foot to the 210, and the renovation numbers again were the 140 to 165 range. So to correct the cost models to be more specific to New Hampshire, more specific to Portsmouth, we made those adjustments.
The initial number, the 210, that when we reached out to the national firm, when we asked them for their data, their sort of backup, that's when it became clear that the projects they were using as models were really all in Massachusetts and Connecticut.
Rhode Island.
And Rhode Island.
Yeah.
There actually were no schools in New Hampshire, which we had thought when we first reached out to them. There had been, because they do work up here, but they hadn't done school work up here.
Right.
So the 210 was skewed high, but I mean, it's not a number that we're not used to seeing in a lot of work in other parts of the Northeast. But when we did talk to the more local firms about schools specifically and other municipal projects of similar size and scope and quality level, that's when the numbers that Doug offered, those were mm-hmm. four New Hampshire constructed projects,
right.
or projects mm-hmm. in New Hampshire.
Okay.
And the interesting timing-wise, when we did that analysis, that's when the state published their new, or 2009 reimbursement rates at the $180 a square foot. When we first started this exercise, they were at $154 a square foot. So again, they're recognizing the impact of the market and the cost of construction.
And the state ties their guideline to, I believe it's RS Means, which is a national database of construction costs that's then regionally adjusted, and they've been sort of pegging their rates to the RS Means rate, and it's been mm-hmm. rising. I think several years ago it was about 120 right. somewhere, so it's clearly been in an upward trajectory. This year went up more than they were frankly expecting. When we first had our conversations earlier in the year, we were expecting to be in the 164.
About 160, 162. They were expecting about a 5% increase, and actually went to, I believe it was 17%.
Increase in their allocation
right.
for what they believe or what they'll reimburse for.
Okay, so just to be clear, and Kent, I see you. So the state went from, within 1 year, they jumped from what they thought was a reasonable amount of money per square foot of $154 to $180, which they believe still, currently anyway,
in this county, and they do it county by county, so it's
So this is this county?
It's in this, yeah.
That's for Rockingham County.
That's for Rockingham County.
Oh, okay.
They do it county by county.
So it could be lower in another part of the state.
Absolutely.
Correct.
It actually is.
It is lower in other parts
Absolutely.
Of the state. Okay. Kent, yes.
And I've asked this. What was the national firm that you consulted with? Do you know who it was?
I know who it was. Again, in the interest of protecting the process, not to impact anything.
Well, what was the what was the state firm that you used?
Again, they're reacting to public information
Well, I have a great anxiety with this, because in the past process that we did this with, you know, they get their numbers from someplace. I mean, and they get their numbers from architectural firms. They work consulting, and that's how they get them. And I really resent that we are getting information on guesstimates of numbers, and they do float. I absolutely agree with that. Live through that through the high school, and then until you get your guaranteed maximum price locked in, you really are at the mercy of what the economy is doing. And as right now, the economy is very favorable in the building world. And that, you know, I have firm belief that, you know, I heard the word firms used on a number of times, that we are not overstepping anything by trying to find out where this information comes from, because as you said on county, it even varies a little bit from county, because Nashua and Salem, I'm sorry, Salem's in Rockingham County, Nashua and Concord actually may have a different rate on it too, because of construction in city type things. I mean, the most absurd in New England right now is the high school being built in Newton, Massachusetts, $200 million. Where my grandfather was principal many, many years ago. I'm sure he's turning in his grave. And you know, we see this, and this is where I get, you know, concerned when we go outside the state utilizing information, is that it's a bigger circle. I attended, you know, many construction meetings when we were doing the high school, and there is a shared dialogue, and I understand protecting it, but I'm just going on record, and I'll go on record tomorrow night in a regular meeting, stating that I have great concerns that we don't know internally in the state where this number is really coming from, because that's unfair, that maybe if you talk to only one firm, a construction management firm, you've got one price, and that firm might be looked upon more favorably when we get to being built upon, and that would bother me too. So again, I just say that these numbers vary, and you did a great job, both of you, in presenting this. I like my backup documents on this and my backup numbers on it, just so that when it's asked, because when we built the high school, I'll tell you right now, we weren't allowed to go outside the state because of the sitting city council then. Matter of fact, they all thought we could get everything in the city.
So outside the state for?
Any bidding.
Oh, so like an architect? Oh.
They did not allow us. Right. We had to stay within the state for it, because they wanted to make sure it was a local type thing. And that held us.
So that was a council policy kind of.
Yeah, it was not a mandate, but it was, you don't do it, suggestion. We're going to come down on you. It was highly suggested. Right. So. I Doug, don't, please, guys, don't take this personal. I just find that if I'm hearing firms, there shouldn't be a problem. If I know that this is only one construction management firm that you went with, that bothers me.
Discuss in work session. That's a fair statement. I mean, the number is coming from JCJ, where we've taken input from four construction management firms, to be clear about that, four that we reached out to, that we have various relationships with, because that's how our industry works. You kind of check information. One of those, the very first one, was it's a large national construction manager. The reason we've been not wanted to share the names specifically is because we didn't tell them we would. You know, when we reached out to kind of find out what their numbers were looking like, we didn't say, gee, can we kind of publicly say that this is your number? And I don't think it's fair to them unless we've asked that, and we're a little worried about whether that might give an unfair advantage or you know, be some problem as you go down the road for CM selection. So there were four. One of them was, you know, as it turned out, all the numbers they gave us was based on out-of-state work, which is why we then said, okay, that's really not what we asked for. Thanks, guys. We appreciate your input, but it didn't help. The three other firms that we reached out to are all New Hampshire-based construction managers who do public school and public work in the state of New Hampshire, including in Portsmouth. So those three.
And Rockingham County.
And Rockingham County. So those three firms were, we reached out to three reputable, well-known, if we, you know, you know them all. I know you do. Mm-hmm. But again, we didn't say to them, gee, could we go and kind of share all your numbers? And I don't know if they'd like us to share what they gave us either, because some of that's proprietary information that they've shared. We took that, as Doug has explained, we had a range, like you would on bid day as well. We had a low, we had a high, we had a middle. We worked with our construction people in-house. We looked at, used our judgment, our own kind of internal check on this, and put together, in our best professional judgment for you, what we thought a good budget would be. And again, I would reinforce, we're giving you budgets. And just like the high school came in under, we would expect you would not spend all of this, but it would be irresponsible of us not to give you contingencies and
right. Escalation
numbers, because we wouldn't want to be in a position where you approve a number and then we're back a year later for another $1 million or $2 million. We don't do that, and we wouldn't want you to have to do that. So again, the number comes from JCJ. We didn't just take
a
number from a company. This is our number. We put a lot of time and effort and judgment into, gee, what do we think is the right number? Now, we came up with the 185 a week before the state then published their 180. And their number seems to have tracked pretty consistently with other school construction. That, when they said it was 120, the numbers were all close to there. When they said the number was 154, the numbers, seemed to be around there, because they obviously do their homework too. So, is the number 180? Could be, and maybe we should adjust our number down and use the state number. The other thing we would suggest is that when you're doing your budgeting, if we budget below 180, that's going to impact what we are budgeting for reimbursement, because it's our understanding, and Steve, certainly you could jump in, that if you, they're not going to reimburse you for money you don't spend. So if they reimburse up to 180 and we somehow do 165, you'll get 165. You won't get the 180. So from a budgetary point of view, it may not on paper right now make sense to budget less than 180, mm-hmm. because that's the target number for the state. That would maximize your reimbursement. If you do the math, because we actually did the math, and when we dropped it down a little bit lower, all of a sudden the city share went up proportionally, because they're not going to give you the 180 anymore.
Right. So that opens up that question. So, what is the difference between 185 and 180? In terms of money. I mean, what would the impact on this building be?
In terms of actual construction, I don't believe we are at a level of detail fine enough that a $5 square foot difference is something we could get to. If we were well into design or construction documents, sure, we could talk about that. Right now, I think it would be perfectly reasonable to budget at 180. We've got enough contingency and escalation that would more than cover any,
right.
Any $5 square foot issue. So I think that's a reasonable thing for us to perhaps consider,
and to match the state.
We would be happy to stand behind a recommendation to reduce the number to $180 a square foot to be compliant with the state number. We came out so close, and this is again a budgetary exercise,
right.
Not a hard bid. That I think that's a,
right.
That would be a reasonable thing to do.
But if we were to do that, and it saved because in terms of the actual bond vote, it saved $300,000-$400,000. I mean, that would make it 44.4 instead of 44.8.
I'm being $600,000 is being whispered in my left ear when you reduce that. We've apparently done the math on
that's
it.
That's what I came up with, actually 6205.
Yeah. So that's somewhere in there would be that net change. That wouldn't be we couldn't tell you at this point that's a
right.
substantive change to the building.
Okay.
We arrived at 185 through our methodology. The state arrived at 180 through theirs. I think we are certainly within the error of this kind of exercise, and I would err on the low side, because again, Ken is also correct that the economy is not doing so well. I will say that I've talked to a number of construction firms as recently as Friday at a statewide a school board association meeting in Connecticut, and they're not yet seeing really big dips in the subcontracting bids, but they're suspecting things are starting to level off. Copper prices have gone down. Obviously, the cost of oil has dropped. So, optimistically, the silver lining to this kind of an economy is usually that you can build more for less.
Okay.
So another thing we actually were talking about all the way up in the car was, again, the crystal ball number, which is escalation. You know, again, it's probably reasonable, we're thinking at this point, to reduce that a little bit, because certainly even in the last 8 weeks since we did these budgets,
mm-hmm.
we've seen projects stop, we've seen construction come to a halt. We've heard stories of 20 contractors showing up for small projects that would have attracted five 2 months ago. So I think you're absolutely correct that the market is softening, and we may want to take that into account as well.
Can you come up with a sort of a number sometime by tomorrow, so we can just sort of talk about a little bit at the school board meeting?
Yeah, we'll email you in the morning a kind of an updated number based on a couple of things.
Consider the 180 and
please me.
I'll email it.
I love the way you guys work together.
Teamwork, it's wonderful.
Well, I mean that's, this is obviously critically important, and I just want to reiterate, it's a budget, we certainly would expect.
Right.
On bid day, that you would be getting a bid lower than this.
Right.
But ideally, not a lot lower, but lower.
But I do feel, like I said earlier, from my perspective, that I need to be confident that you're confident that the number we vote, you can build what you're telling us you can build. So if you can trim some money off that and still feel confident, then I'm comfortable.
Well, I think the two areas I just cited we've talked a lot about that in the last week, about the 185 versus the 180. And also kind of where the economy is. Now, again, that's whose crystal ball is good. The escalation numbers are always,
right.
I will say that when we first started this process over the summer, again, a couple of large construction managers publish the Turners, the Gilbanes, the Heeries of the world, the very large national firms, all publish kind of quarterly reports, and they copy us on a lot of it. And they were saying 8-12% escalation. They were telling their estimators mm-hmm. as late as August to include 8-12% escalation for next year right. in all of your budgeting. Obviously, we didn't heed that. We looked at it, and nothing else we saw thought it was that high.
So six.
We had six, and five may be the right number, and okay. that's kind of where we're.
So if you could do that and get me some information, that would be very helpful.
Sure.
Yes, Lisa.
On a different point, kind of talking about sort of the cost. Is there a time to mention that, the study circles, which, really kind of drove this process to where it is,
uh-huh.
And those, sort of estimates that were on the table, the cost there, the expected cost at Paired Ave was, I think it was $41 million plus $7 million for five fields uh-huh. elsewhere. Which really isn't too far off. It was $48 million, but $7 million of that was for fields, for five fields elsewhere.
Right.
So really, if you're looking at that site, it was $41 million.
Okay, so we're close.
I don't know. I mean, that was a pretty soft number, I think, at the time, but I don't know if it's worth bringing that up.
You just did.
Okay, but... When we
well, I mean, like I say, what I'm expecting for Monday and then the following Monday is, this is a work session between the City Council and the School Board. They're going to have questions. We're going to have answers. We're going to have questions. I have one big question. I mean, we've spent a lot of time on this, and I feel, I understand a lot of some of the details and what goes into this, and here we are. And I would like, somebody to try to explain to me based on what we know, how you can build what we're asking for with two fields and eminent domain, everything in on Parrot Avenue for $40 million. That's my question for the City Council.
Yeah,
I want to know how we can do it, because if we can do it, I want to do it.
Right.
So just for the sake of moving on, thank you. The next slide, I don't know how to describe. and I don't want to take up too much time. I mean, I don't want to be here all night, but. This is the comparative cost. The question is, as Councillor Clayburgh has raised and many people have raised, and how is it possible that all these other schools built for whatever cost they built at? So I kind of just asked JCJ to help us out a little bit. I mean, as best as possible, we don't have all information on every school that was built, and we don't have the detail of their budget. but maybe to sort of begin to understand some comparative costs. And the word draft will be out of there. Don't worry. Yes, Rebecca, before Jay, yeah.
I have a question.
This slide may be too complicated, so I don't know.
No, I like, is Ware Middle School a new building?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it, what does it look like? Is it just a cinder block building? Does it have any architectural features?
I don't know.
It's a gorgeous building. I've toured it, and if you talk about the Unified Arts, John went and has toured it. Their group areas were nice. They also had a common area that was their cafeteria and auditorium, I think. Is that right, John?
They had a stage built into their cafeteria. They called it a cafetoria.
And on the other side, they actually had a group use area. It's
I'm sure it's a nice school.
I mean, I'm just wondering why.
I'm sure it's a beautiful school.
You know,
well, this is the question. This is what you know.
Not great materials?
We don't know. We've not been. That's one of the schools.
Because I think if we don't have these answers,
And I'm aware. I'll speak very loudly on it. I do went on the tour. I talked deeply with the superintendent and the principal of the school. Just like anything in construction, there were things that went on where they were doing it. They are extremely happy with it. There was not, as I unfortunately heard. And I don't think it's fair when I heard the subgroup talking about this in the last week's meeting. They didn't go to Home Depot type bidding. They use really good materials overall. Their cafeteria is absolutely in that area. Their gymnasium's gorgeous. And again, one of the differences that has to be pointed out here, it's 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. So they have a little bit more common area that they use on it.
Right.
But they have their specialty. They have a art teacher that does rock carving, I guess. I don't know how you call it. He's a sculptor. And that's one of the things that he gets into. That school's very proud of. So, you know, they talk about it. But, again, if you're doing a comparison, I think it's a good comparison to it. I don't know the Laconia Middle School.
Well, I want to ask JCJ to maybe just walk us a little bit. I mean, it's difficult to understand the numbers.
If we look at, you know, back before.
Let's let them talk through it so we can understand where they are.
Well, it is. I mean, before I turn over to Doug, I will preface it by saying it is very difficult to compare any two buildings as a true, apples to apples comparison, because you simply don't know the full picture, the full details, and we don't know the full budget story. There's a lot of publications that are out that have all kinds of, costs per square foot for school buildings, and it's always difficult because everyone does this a little bit differently. So, we've done our best to try to understand. Sometimes the explanation is it was a different time and a different place, and the same brick cost less money.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of the explanation with some of these. Clearly, is that the time differential is fairly significant. They applied for their state aid in 2005. When did we estimate the midpoint of construction was?
That was the midpoint of construction.
Okay. Was
2005.
So, we're budgeting to 2011. So that's a big swing. I mean, that's a lot of escalation that occurs over there. But I'll turn it over to Doug. We did our best to try to come up with some meaningful comparison. We may have missed something in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Doug.
Again, we turn to RS Means as a nationally recognized standard. In each of their guides, they have historical cost indexes that allow you to be able to compare construction projects in one region to another, and then based on that price index for that particular county, you're then able to take a project from, say, 2005 and escalate it to today's dollars, 2008. So we did that with Ware. We'll start with that. Using information that was provided to us from their state form, the A24P,
mm-hmm.
We are able to determine what their construction costs are, construction costs being site and building. Okay, we don't have the detail in terms of, we didn't break it down to the detail in terms of the site development costs and building costs. We took it as a construction number for this comparison. So using the RS Means index, comparing it to Portsmouth from the Hillsborough County, we were able to escalate their state number to 2008. We then had to escalate the 2008 number to the midpoint of our construction, which we're forecasting to be 2011. So again, we used the same 6% escalation over 2.5 years to arrive at the number of $25 million. And again, we used the size of the school, 131,000 square feet, to arrive at a square foot cost, site and building, at $192 a square foot. And what I wanted to point out again, Hillsborough County back in 2005 was reimbursing, state was reimbursing at $120 a square foot. We use the same information from Laconia. It's a project that's currently under construction. So again, their number, you saw there's no need for us to escalate that number from, we estimate the midpoint of construction at 2006. The reason we use the midpoint, just by explanation, that's when the majority, if not all of the subcontracts are bought out. So you're not buying additional work after the midpoint of construction. And then all we had to do for Laconia is escalate that cost to 2011. So we arrived at the same midpoint of construction for our project. And again, at $118, about 18,000 square feet, that was just that under $192 a square foot, site and building. Using our the numbers that were in the October 17th cost model, you see the cost of construction at 28.8, the escalation 4.3, construction cost of 33.1 over the 132,000 square feet, that arrives at the $252 a square foot. And again, the difference there, you can see the reimbursement rates, again, reflecting the cost of construction from the time the construction was started to today, that falls into that delta, that $60 delta.
Okay. So the comparable, so we're looking at 25, 22, and we're at 33.
Correct.
Okay. Any questions on that? Just to move on, it's 8:30. This next slide is really maybe comes out. The question in my mind really is answering the question, why Parrot Avenue? It's the cost of staying downtown, and this is really not, this is the non-financial cost, so maybe this doesn't need to be here. This was just part of the way I think. Yes.
Correct me if I'm wrong, John, but if you keep that, I think Parrot has two T's.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Got it.
Yeah, two R's, two T's.
Okay. But I don't necessarily know if this is an important slide. Does anyone disagree with that?
If we have the cost premiums, we should keep this in there, too.
I think it reinforces that added cost of staying on Parrot Ave.
Yeah, works.
Well, this is really why on Parrot Ave.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's not correctly called the cost, but right. I mean, this is the community, I wouldn't say has asked, you know, the community has, it's the preferred option. Mm.
Strong.
Suggest
what? Okay. And honor the master plan, as people were telling us, the city council actually has asked us themselves to commit to Parrot Avenue when we didn't. Okay. We said we're prepared, and we will commit soon when we vote. It's in the heart of the city. As I said earlier, it's taking advantage of existing infrastructure. That's a green concept. It also saves money. And, you know, I think the thing that always stuck out to me is that we were asked to sort of search out an architectural firm who could help us deal with an urban problem. How do you build a middle school, expand the middle school in the middle of downtown? And we found a company that has experience doing that. So we need to embrace urban solutions. And that's really where that's what we're trying to do. So one of the biggest ones we have to embrace is the issue of fields. So what I want to do is just pass out some more information here. Let's see. What I'm passing out is three pieces of paper. This is very similar to the information I handed out at the ad hoc committee. The first one is green space analysis that JCJ has done. City councilors had asked the question, and we've had this for a while, since October 9th. the city council had asked the question, how much will the building encroach on the alumni property? And this one, too. And so here's in that green space analysis, that you can actually look at it and gives you a clear sense of exactly where the school's going to be. Apologize if the reproduction is not clear enough, but so that's just really more informational. The other piece, piece of information is that I'm handing out. One is a schedule of the games, and so maybe Russ, you could sort of help us on this, that Lisa Sweet gave to us on the committee, which looks at all of the middle school practices and games and teams, where they practice, where they play. The other sheet of paper, not to confuse you, is when we talk about parking. So basically, you know, in terms of the fields, and Kent and Russ, you could help a little bit because I don't think I have all of the recommendations that came forward, but I thought part of what was being recommended, and again, you know, we cannot by ourselves solve this issue. So this is an issue that we need to come to an agreement with the city council on, because depending on where we go, this money's in the budget and this is the package. But we need to make recommendations to show people that we're trying to come up with at what we believe, what the rec department believes, the athletic director believes, and the administration believes will satisfy the needs of the middle school students for their athletic program. So some of the suggestions that I've heard, and you'll correct me, is possibly building two new fields on, and I don't know if it's actually called Sagamore Hill, but
yes, it is.
But, okay. And going back to some of the information from the earlier team design with Appledore Engineering, this was just a thrown out number, so maybe we should take it off the slide. I don't know if it's really pertinent. And yes, what?
Well, I worry about mixing. On the one hand, okay. We say we can't use that.
I'm just saying that there is some. There has been an estimate of some infrastructure costs out there somewhere, but got
I'll go over these, and Russ and John and actually Steve and Bob,
yes, please,
and Jeff were in these meetings. We had a total of four meetings. We were planning a fifth meeting, but my schedule didn't work out towards it, and that was to just review these three options. And again, these are, we don't even want to call we don't call these recommendations.
What do you call them?
We were calling these analysis. There is great detail that goes behind these. This is the simplified type wording. The analysis broke these down into, first of all, John's needs at the middle school for phys ed, that we know that you can't truck kids off for phys ed, and that the field that is shown actually fairly well on this one here, which shows physical education field properly noted, you know, probably 80% or more of the outdoor physical education can be met there and not have to go across the street to use the fields over in Larry Field and the Little League Field. So we were fairly confident after great discussion, and I think John would concur and Russ would concur, the physical ed programs could be all met on site. Is that correct, John?
Correct.
The then issue comes, and again, we did not get into discussion of what the Pierce property swap would be. We did not discuss that. We didn't feel that was our purvey to get into. It was nothing that we wanted to talk what would meet meeting the Pierce Trust trade. We did not get into any discussion other than wanting to say that it is a joint thing to work with the city with. In discussing this, there were really three options, and safety was the biggest issue that both Jeff and John Stokel. It is not preferred by any administrator to bus these kids. And oddly enough, I ran into a nice pair of ladies at the coffee shop that have great history in the city, and they said they went through the same, in their words, debacle back when the high school was on Islington Street, that there were no fields there, and these athletes during that period of time were moved around for a great period of time. So there is nothing really that can be utilized across the street on a continuous basis for either games for the middle school or practices. Some practices could happen on the physical educational field there, but not all. Obviously, you couldn't fit both soccer and lacrosse in at the same time. So we discussed, you know, how practices were and then games. We discussed all options. We looked at about six or seven sites, both public and private sites in the city, of what could be used. And the analysis that we came up with were to meet minimally, and I think there's one discussion point, we have to talk about this artificial turf here in just a second, was that Sagamore Hill, and I heard this and I take great issue, was not a code word. It is absolutely what that has named. So those that think that this is some hiding of something, it's actually a piece of property on top. There are good estimates of what that would cost, total renovations on that field or that property to make it somewhat used. What is not is the infrastructure that would be to go up there. So there's a difference. You have the infrastructure and you have the field. A ballpark figure of $2 million to get a road up there, I think, is good. I don't think you're out of sight. That, having two fields and being, if possible, and need to expand down the road, is a good option. You can have two fields to begin with, and if you needed to add more, and council and the board later on in life wanted to. It also met a little bit better than the safety, and I know there's a strong desire with the stump dump. There is great safety issues of having students left or at the stump dump area, no matter what. And there is still discussion with many in the community whether the stump dump will or will not fit a field. I know Russ gets bombarded with this on a regular basis. Will it meet the softball field? Yeah, you can squeeze it in. Do you get everything you need? Who knows? But again, there also will be an infrastructure number that we don't have. Call it $2 million, you know, it's comparable to whether you go to Sagamore Hill or there. You're going to have to bring lights in. You're going to have to bring road in. You're going to have to pay for parking. All that type of stuff the same.
So what you get, just a quick question. So what you're saying is, if we go in that direction, which is to do two fields up on Sagamore Hill, up above the $2.25 million we're talking about in terms of constructing the fields, it could be easily at least $2 million more in terms of unknown infrastructure.
And you're going to have that also, I think, to some discussion when you go down to the stump dump. Obviously, you're not going to have as much of a road going in, but you're still going to have to put your lights in, your water, for your sprinklers and so forth.
So that makes it totally out of our range.
So what's the recommendation? So
the third option, or there's an option here that with we do the artificial turf at the school. At the high school, at the current high school. Okay. This would eliminate. And I think it should be known right now, and I'll bring this up tomorrow night, that without the hard work of Russ, Ken Lynchy, and many others, the semi-championship game that happened 2 weeks ago would not have happened. The state condemned our field until we could make proper recommendations on it. So we have an issue with the field no matter what we want. There is a letter coming, Russ is going to get it, that the football game almost didn't happen there, which is a crying shame. Not to go much further is that I think at the state level, no middle school, and I did the research, has put anything that's artificial within their budget lines. So I think that's going to be an issue.
Can I ask you just to help us with this last, not recommendation, but analysis. So walk us through what you're suggesting here.
Well, the suggestions here is you could build two fields up on Sagamore.
Right, we got that. It's expensive. It's going to be expensive.
I think we have to watch when we say it's expensive. If we're wanting to work with the city, and the city can get its 33%, and they're going to eliminate some issues, it's something we have to put out there. Field adjacent to the then there was the second recommendation, which was
I'm missing one here.
Yeah, you are. You're missing the one that is the artificial. You had three. One was the artificial field, and the stump dump. That was minimal and didn't meet all the safety requirements that the group thought were there, because you do have remoteness for students of
high
school.
So look at 2B.
2B.
2B talks about moving, because I saw this suggestion as a package. One is the field, what you just said, the adjacent field to the middle school will satisfy all after-school athletic practices. Is that correct?
No.
That's not correct.
No. Russ, can you go with that?
John could probably answer better than I do. We have different opinions on that. I don't think the fields can satisfy the requirements now, what you have. If you take away fields or reduce size of fields, at least reduce acreage. And God knows what will happen over the next, you say you're building this year for the, building a school for the next 70 years. Nobody heard of lacrosse 10 years ago. Nobody heard of soccer 20 years ago in Portsmouth. And all those things take up a half, two-thirds of our fields now.
Right.
So if you're building something for 70 years, we can only imagine what other sports will come into place. I don't think there's adequate fieldage now for practices.
Right.
John thinks he can squeeze it on. So we differ there, and there's certainly not any place to play regulation field games here.
Okay, so dealing with the after-school practices,
right.
Besides the field next to the new field, possibly next to it, non-regulation size, and possibly fields across the street after school is out.
Correct. We use that for a multitude of other activities.
Right.
The middle school will have no more or no less than it has now.
Okay. Would those two fields together satisfy all of the middle school team practices, not games, just practices throughout the...
Well, they practice on Clough Field,
I was just going to say, the other one is they currently go to Clough Field.
They use all the fields now. You use Clough Field now, you use Leary Field now, you use Central now, you use all those fields now.
Okay. So with the addition of this new field, we would at least be able to continue what we're doing and now have some practices next door and satisfy practices after school.
With the addition of what field are you saying?
The one that the new one that they're going to build to the
next
non-regulation
year.
Next
well, you're taking
school.
Away alumni.
Right.
Correct.
Net,
and there's a field.
Actually a net loss, in my opinion.
Yes, I understand that. But there's also going to be this non-regulation size grass space next to the middle school,
correct.
Which the principal says can also help towards after-school athletic practices.
Correct. But you're taking away alumni field.
I understand that.
Okay.
Yes. So part of it, what I'm saying is, I'm trying to get at the cheapest way for us to satisfy the state, to satisfy the middle school athletic program, and to satisfy the needs of athletic programs in Portsmouth.
And the cheapest way to do that would be Roman numeral two.
Okay, that's where I'm getting at.
Correct.
Okay, so we can deal with the practices
as is with
the new space next to the school building. We're taking away alumni field. I got it. The issue is games. Now, where are they going to play the games? Because they cannot play the games on those things.
Correct.
And that's where the artificial turf
correct.
Comes
if the high school field was artificial turf, you could play all your large field games at the high school.
And okay.
All your other games would remain where they are. A baseball would remain across the street. Softball would go to the softball field.
Right.
All your large field games would go to the high school.
And just to clarify in that discussion is that this is and it'll keep Russ and whoever employed, it's a constant scheduling because you will begin with your middle school games first and then your high school games, and then if there are any adult things, they would be scheduled later on. And with travel and so forth, you would have games that would go for the high school as late as 9 o'clock. And again, those safety and time element were things that we constantly
right.
talked about on that were issues. And safety really came up.
Rebecca, you had a question. Sorry.
I have a comment and a question. And a question for Russ. I just have to say that I can never support any option that involves the use of the Jones Ave, Sagamore Creek, Sagamore Hill area. So
gotcha.
Just so you all know where I'm coming from, if that's tied to the school, that kills it for me. To me, that area needs to stay as is open. I also have a really hard time accepting Kent LePage's recommendations, considering he was very active in his group to put five fields out there and move the school
from
downtown.
I'm going to take issue. I never did that. In fact, Mitch was the one that was on that committee. I did not ever sit on that committee. Rebecca, please
correct.
Get your facts straight.
No, you gave us a presentation in this very room about field locations. And I just see it as
a... That Mitch had me do.
I just see it as a conflict of interest. That's all. I just had to say that I find that as a conflict.
Rebecca, you're off balance on that.
Necessarily a conflict of interest. Kent has knowledge about the fields.
Right.
And we're tapping into the strengths.
Fair enough.
But let me... Five fields short in the city.
That's really what he was saying.
There's five fields, and that's what we have said constantly. There are five fields short.
I understand, and that's a city issue.
And the rec department.
Yeah.
And my comment towards this is the only place that is not going to be of a cost consequence down the road is somewhere up in that location that allows it. And the rec board has looked at it. I believe Russ can correct me. I think the earliest I remember going out there was around 97, 96. We took a look at that. And
so you're talking about potential expansion for athletic fields in the city.
Correct.
We're not talking about that now.
Okay.
That's correct.
That's fine.
But just to your point, we as a board can't solve this, right?
Absolutely.
So all we have is the ability to make recommendations as possible. You know, the JBC, when they get together, we're going to make some suggestions as how to solve this, you know, which actually this last one sounds good. But it's not our call in the end.
And I'm just going to make a comment. Rebecca, you participated in the study circles, so maybe you're clouded towards that.
Actually, I was away the first week,
that's
so
off
I wasn't
point.
That.
Okay, but
so
again,
let's continue.
I take great issue.
And that's fair enough, and I apologize if I offended you. That wasn't my intent.
Well, greatly was.
I do have a question for us, if I may.
I don't know now. Just kidding. Yes.
My question for you, Russ, is on boys lacrosse and field hockey, those are the only two that practice only on alumni field. They don't practice anywhere else. Can you tell me why are girls softball and girls lacrosse, why they can split practice between alumni and somewhere else?
I don't think I understand your question. Why they can split practice?
Yeah,
this isn't Russ's piece of paper.
Yeah.
This is Lisa's piece of paper.
Lisa, could you tell me why you have girls varsity softball under spring that they practice on alumni and the Little League field? I'm just curious as to, is it a scheduling?
I think it's I got this information from Matt Mitchell, mm-hmm. and the question that I asked was, what teams do we have now?
Mm-hmm.
Where are they practicing and where are they playing their games, so that we knew what is the athletic program that we need to support with our project that we're working on.
I can help you a little bit with that. The Portsmouth High School team uses alumni for all their practices and all their games.
Okay.
So a lot of times
when it's not available, girls lacrosse goes to Clough.
And another point on this sheet is fall of 2008 and spring of 2008. So there's only one girls soccer team. Some years there's a JV and a varsity.
Two this year.
Oh, there were?
There were two this year.
Oh, see, that's wrong then.
Okay.
So anyway, the teams, there may be more or less teams depending on
those. Yeah, so this is really just to help make a point as to where they practice and where some of the
games
are played.
It's just sort of a snapshot of the current situation.
Cut in stone. These are some of the issues that have to be solved. Yes.
Our soccer, I can't speak to the other sports because I don't know, but the girls and boys soccer teams at the middle school do not play on a regulation field now. So my question is...
You mean their games?
They don't play their games. If they're home games, they do not play on a regulation field because they play at Clough Field.
Okay.
So...
I'm sorry, what sport?
Soccer.
Soccer.
And I know Clough Field is not even close to being regulation. So my question is, what does Ed Murdo say about that? Is he going to say to us, if they're playing on that now... Does that remain okay if we renovate our school? Or do we have to, as part of our program, provide a field that is regulation size? Because they're not playing on it now. As our program exists right now, they're not playing on it.
Let's see what Steve.
When I broached that issue with Ed before, and I've said it a couple of times, that the state didn't want to participate in anything that we went backwards on. And then I said, okay, that's fine. We're not going to go backwards, perhaps. But what if we stay status quo, which is substandard? And he said that they would be hard-pressed to participate in a situation where you put any money into that it was going to be substandard. The state believes that you should, in this process, go through and make regulation-size fields. And if that was not possible, that we would have to get a waiver, but we'd be getting a waiver for going in the wrong direction.
That's
most
true.
People's opinion.
I understand that.
And so he said they would not look favorably on non-regulation fields that you asked for any reimbursement on.
But he also made the point to me very clearly that as a middle school, he would not support an artificial turf field, that there are no middle schools that have an artificial turf field, and he would not support that.
So let's get into this.
And so I asked the same question because that was part of the point. The point was if we have option two here, which would be resurfacing the high school field, as Mitch aptly pointed out, there is a prohibition stated that they will not participate in resurfacing an existing field. So I said, all right, now, but let's look at this. If we have a solution that's $2.25 million, that would mean we'd have to have an extra waiver versus something that might be $5 or $6 million the other way. Would we not be able to at least negotiate this because we'd be saving not only the Portsmouth taxpayers' money, but ultimately the state money? And he said, you would have to do that in the waiver process when you presented it. But that's as much as he would commit to. So did he say that he'd let us do option two? No. Did he say we had a chance to negotiate and try to get a waiver for it? Yes. That's as much as I know as of the last two times I've talked to him, which was recent.
So in my mind, that raises a question, and that is, you know, if, you know, option two really seems to satisfy a lot of our predicament. Do we need to ask the state for some sort of handle on that question before December 31st to get a sense of whether they would consider this multiple waivers under artificial turf? Because if they said no, then that would really change our ability to make that recommendation.
Well, that's one of the things I'm thinking about is if this isn't going to happen without having the field solved, and the field being solved means an artificial turf field, then you know, that in my mind, that's...
Well, I came away from that discussion thinking that before we get the application in, we probably ought to be trying to put a waiver in, and I just hope that there's enough information in that waiver that would allow them to at least give us an inclination.
So is that something that we should do soon?
Like, the discussion that we had in that group is that, you know, if we resolve a lot of things, because we do not have a and girls lacrosse is the absolute largest sport, and that if we did do that, we would be meeting that and increasing our high school usage. I think in your waiver, again, playing the truth in lending, you would have to say this is going to help us at two levels within the school system
and the city,
and that Stella, that the artificial turf. We are at, like I said, a crisis with the high school field, and I know Russ can back this up 100% that if they don't do it, this board is going to have to look at dumping an extremely large amount of money on a single project, which may or may not. So it's worth a try. That group is willing to meet again. Jeff is committed. I know John is committed, and Russ is committed to coming up with a resolution, at least for the game fields, which would be that one field.
Well, that's the piece.
And he seemed to indicate when I talked to him that the fact that there was collateral benefit to a middle school project to the high school would not necessarily be looked at unfavorably.
Right.
But it wouldn't, if it looked like we were trying to do it just to get the high school thing, then that would be looked on unfavorably. So I think it behooves us to write our waiver quickly and thoroughly.
So when, Sherry, I just had a question too.
Go ahead, ask your question.
So, I mean, does the board informally ask you to do that?
I think tomorrow night you should do that.
To ask you to write the waiver or contact them? I mean,
to write. I think you should probably. My recommendation would be that you instruct the administration to put together a waiver for option two on the fields.
So be it.
Okay. So for option 2B, is that the one we're doing? Move softball field to the stump dump and put artificial turf on the high school?
I really caution us to say the stump dump because.
What are you talking about?
Another location? Okay, I don't want to get held up in technicalities. Mm-hmm. If we move the softball field to some other spot, do we have middle school students that need to use this other spot?
For softball.
Do we need
for a softball field?
Yes.
If you want to play on a regulation softball field, yes.
So that's where they would go for their games.
Correct.
Yeah, but we have to suggest where that is.
Games and practices.
I mean, we can't just say some spot. We need to.
I thought all practices were right there on the premises after school.
Practice.
That's where they are right now.
Telling me even a practice would have to go to this other location. So yes or no?
No.
High school girls softball would have to move.
I only want to know about the middle school students' practice.
Mr. Stokoe.
The middle school softball teams now hold many practices across the street on the Little League field because alumni field was being used by the high school softball teams for games.
So we would keep that same practice.
What I would be recommending is all practices are on site, and the only time we would bus to this new softball field is for games, and that would be a regulation softball field.
Okay, so they would be going there for the softball games, and they would theoretically be going to the high school for all the other games on this
on a regulation field.
Correct.
Except for softball. Your softball.
Except for softball. So if I could ask Russ, so am I hearing that that the stump dump or would not work at all for a softball field? Am I hearing that?
No, we think it can. Oh. I think it can.
It can, but it's
so what's your concern about that?
That John and Jeff consider that location is not it's on railroad tracks. You have elements that go there.
You okay with the safety?
The safety was the concern of my having to bus students to practices. When we go to a game, the coach is going to ride the bus with the students to the game, be with these athletes during the entire contest, and then ride that bus back to the school.
But John, that was not Jeff's, because Jeff would have to have practices there, and his concern was also safety. Because the high school students would have to be practicing there, because it's...
But that's not relevant for our project.
This is the middle school.
But I hear what you're saying, but the safety issue...
You want to throw... Wait a minute. You want to throw high school girls out in an area that could be... And it is our concern, because whether it's the middle school kids, and John's going to have his practices there, Russ is going to have to make sure that we can transport over to the stump dump, for lack of better terms.
That's a different conversation.
Well, let's come up with another name for it then. I don't know what it's called.
We should have a
stump dump. Stump dump.
But that seems to be, you know, I think Steve's suggestion, we ask him tomorrow night at the official meeting, we take a vote on it to ask him to create the waiver. Because if we can do that as a solution and it gets us to build the middle school building, that's a really good solution. All the other things would have to work itself out somehow. Yes, Russ.
The only thing I got to add, Mitch, is we have no other alternatives.
We have no other alternatives.
We have the stump dump for a piece of land. We have the high school football field as an artificial site. Short of going up to the other alternatives that we mentioned, that's the only alternative we have left.
Okay.
Which are way over budget.
Right.
The other alternatives.
Right. This brings you in. We
at
think,
what we have already
at your
been
budget.
Budgeted. See, that's what I like.
We have to do it.
Well, yes, and then I want to move on.
Okay. Who currently now uses the high school field during the time that all those games are
all
now
right,
going to be played? I mean, who will be displaced? The
no
band
one.
Or any practices?
It's unused probably 60 to 70% of the time, because it just gets so torn up.
And it needs to
for
rest.
Use, it just
Thank
has
you.
To sit there.
Okay. So you are sure that all of the games and
Absolutely.
Everything can be accommodated?
And we can schedule it out for you.
Okay. Wait. Oh, and then when we talk about safety at this dump dump and at off-site fields, I mean, I understand the reason that you kind of want a field near a school is for safety, so that if there is an accident or something, you can run to a facility and get help, or if there's a lightning storm, you can run to the gym and go inside or whatever.
Yeah.
When we talk about building out at the stump dump or wherever, you know, what is built into our price now? Is it just the fields? Is it like a
just
little
it's
lean-to or anything, like a phone?
Is there bleachers or what, all that?
You know, I know it includes some things and not others.
It's the thing that doesn't have a price.
It's the field, the lights for the field, the fencing for the field, bleachers.
Parking spaces.
No, we didn't.
No.
We didn't include parking.
Not.
It's okay. Everything. It's everything you need to have a fully functioning field with the lights and bleachers and
minus the
fences. We didn't. The budget doesn't include road improvements, running utilities into the field. It didn't include.
So it would include having like a restroom there or a, you know, wouldn't include, that would be in the other.
That's part of the infrastructure cost, as was irrigation for the fields.
Okay.
And they are natural turf fields.
Right, and so they would need it. I'm done.
Okay, thank you. So this other slide I have on fields, I'm just going to throw out because it's really more notes to myself for those things that we just talked about. So, you know. But you have it in your presentation if you want to read it.
Sure.
So now we come to parking. Hey, this is another issue we can't solve by ourselves. but we can only make recommendations and, you know, short of which nobody wants to do, putting a parking lot on the property. But so what we've handed out are a couple of things. On one of this double-sided site proposed, this one is a picture from JCJ's original presentation back in August. What I did on the other side of it, though, is I just blew up the image so you could actually read it in terms of parking issues as to where they were relatively at that point in time putting parking. And they came up with a number of 77 parking spots initially. And then as we were, we were looking at this picture, we saw that there were two gymnasiums actually still in the picture, and we're not talking about building two, we're building one. So the idea was, well, can we put more cars there? So if I could ask JCJ to help us address parking.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Steve also handed out another diagram. Much smaller, but what that depicts is we went back and looked at how can we maximize parking on site. The image that was a blow up from a previous diagram had 44 spaces in the courtyard, if you will, or the forecourt of the middle school and library. We looked at increasing the density of the parking there, less green space. We can get approximately 70 cars in that front lot, if you will. You'll have about 24 parking stalls along the drive between the school and the practice field. The area of the second gym, we can fit 18 cars in there. And then we had 8 spaces back by the service area. All totaled, we are recommending we could get 111 spaces on site. There's also a second diagram to the right that if you wanted to fully maximize parking on site, you could then add 154 parking spaces where you have your practice field. In light of the discussion that we just had about fields, we wouldn't recommend that. But again,
John's about ready to shoot you. The library likes you.
By field. Not sure the neighbors would like us very much either.
Correct.
So could you run me through the numbers again?
You should keep one thing in mind.
Yes, yes.
That was the original recommendation.
That's right.
3 years ago.
Right.
Correct.
Before
correct.
JCJ came on board.
Correct.
That all of that green space would turn into asphalt.
Right. Right.
And we have resisted until this moment actually even showing you that because we would not recommend you do that.
Yeah.
No. We think you need the green space and the field. And in fact, even in front of the school, the previous version maintained more green space in front of the addition, between the addition and the library. We're now showing more parking in that area in order to increase this number to 111.
So we're giving up some aesthetic.
Some lawn between the two correct. Buildings mm-hmm. for off-street parking.
Yeah.
And we're also giving up permeable space. I mean,
yes, you're doing more hard surface.
You see that area after a heavy rainstorm, it's underwater, all of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how that gets factored in.
We would have to, as our city approvals, make sure that whatever happens with rainwater, storm runoff, gets accounted for when we upgrade.
But wouldn't that be easier having the green
permeable space? Yeah. Steve?
The other point is that if we are going to, which we are going to, we're going to go for our CHIPS related 3%, the score sheet for that is quite extensive. And one of the things that it talks about is maintaining a certain amount of green space as opposed to paving over the whole world. So I think we would have to. balance that off.
So in other words, it's possible if we went even with this 111 parking spaces, we might not satisfy some of the CHIPS requirements, or we don't know that?
We don't know that.
We don't know that.
There's usually trade-offs, so you can, you know, if we do this, we may have to do something else to try to balance that.
Sherry.
On your 111 on the left-hand picture, or well, it's in both pictures, in the little triangle space, what number was that before you increased it and took out some of the green space?
Well, the 111 is total on site. And we happen to put it there.
Yeah, can you run those numbers through again?
Yeah, I wonder what we changed originally to get our increases. So, like, we have the row across next to the road, and we have the row, you know, in front of that.
Oh, wait, you know
and
what?
We have a row next to the library.
There you go.
Okay. Okay. As you can see on the image on the screen, the two parking lots in the front, we offered 45 parking spaces.
So are you saying the 111 used to be 45?
Sorry,
no.
Jen.
No.
Okay.
Right here.
That 111 is total.
Turned into parking.
Okay, the
so
green turned. Okay.
This way.
Gotcha.
And this box here also becomes a parking lot.
Correct.
Just don't blind them.
And then we still got the eight spaces.
So we're going from we're going from 77 to 111.
111,
correct.
On the school property.
Exactly. Okay.
So these 24 stay.
That's those correct. Stay. We actually added two in there.
Yeah,
so we brought
two.
That up to 26.
Okay.
In front of the library, we have 15 in the 111.
Okay.
The triangular area offers 54 parking spaces.
Okay.
And then we had 18 at the footprint of the second gym.
Sure.
And then 8 at the service area.
So, but you know, in our, so let me just say this other piece of paper that I handed out. Now, this is very unofficial.
Mm-hmm.
I think who did this was Lisa. Actually, just it's a very rough unofficial count.
Although I saw it in some of the city's numbers, so it was actually pretty good.
Oh, okay.
Corroborated myself.
Great. So these are some other parking issue, solutions nearby. Because I'm still not sure that, I mean, 111 makes us reach the number we need in order for the state.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Kent's point in the last conversation about parking in terms of visitor parking and handicap parking and library parking, really the number was up more towards like 150 or 60.
What 100. Is the library? Have we had a recommendation of what they say?
No, we just have to keep them in mind. I've asked that question, but I've never had, I don't have an answer.
They have now.
They currently have 18 in the parking lot.
They have 18 in their front.
Right. And again, I don't know if you recall from a previous presentation, the traffic study that was prepared for the library, although the scheme that is analyzed here is not what was realized, mm-hmm. they're recommending 66 parking spaces for the library.
66
was
originally.
I thought it was about that. Yeah. And they have 18 on their parcel.
Okay. So I guess, but my point is, you know, we need to keep the library in mind, so they're a neighbor. So let's say we're looking at 150, 160 type of thing. You know, we can only make recommendations. We can solve our own issue, I think, right here with 101 spots on. And then we have extra spots for the library and some visitor spots, and they'd have to fight over it. But I think that the recommendation that we make would be multiple options. The city council, I mean, we can only do a recommendation. The city council with the JBC together will solve the actual parking issue as to, so looking at Lisa's page, for example, just some brief counts of, you know, how many spots are on Parrott Avenue and how many in front of the middle school and the lot on Junkins and the playground lot. So there's multiple ways to solve this problem working with the city. It's just clear. Yes, Rebecca.
I just want to comment that all the teachers or everybody parks there now anyway, so we're not, everybody who drives to Parrott Ave parks
mm-hmm.
there now.
Finds a place
so,
to park.
Right, so I think, I mean, I feel like this is really good, and if we put 111 on site, then that frees up the 60 on the street on Parrott Ave, because teachers who park there now aren't, they now can park on the site.
What a good point.
So.
Excellent point.
I'm totally taking credit.
So that helps solve the library's issue too, because many of those spots won't be taken up by teachers. They may be taken up by people who work downtown, but not by teachers.
Well, then, you know, we can have the discussion with the city to permit it for library patrons or.
So. And this, so just getting back to this, so we're suggesting we could fit 111 spots on site and there are other ways in which to help deal with the issue. So I think that that would be our recommendation, that we do we want to try to put 111 spots on site? That's the other question, if we're giving up all that green space.
Well, I have a question, and maybe this wouldn't work, but if we eliminated the 24 parking places next to the field and moved the field over, does it become big enough for any
usable regulation
field?
The challenge we have is where you have that angled property line.
It's the corner that's in the way.
You got that corner down there.
Okay. Yeah.
It's the width, not the length.
Can't you move the school over like 20 feet?
It's still
it's more than that.
They don't even make it now. The only thing that's regulation is softball.
Those blocks move nicely.
I mean, the field, you know, we had talked last time, just to close the loop on that, the field is about 200 by 250, mm-hmm. is the rectangular area, not counting the little piece, which is actually a little larger than the outfield of Alumni Field. I mean, if you drew a rectangle, mm-hmm. on the outfield and didn't hit the dirt or the fence, you've actually got a little bit bigger square rectangular area than you're currently using. So there's a slight improvement there.
Okay. Okay, so we have multiple recommendations that we could make, and there's a way to solve this. Whether we do 111 or not, there's ways to solve this. So this last this is that page, and then just this last page, I don't think I'm going to have it in here, but I think it's part of the documents that are going to us in the City Council, these are just some of the Ed 321 requirements that the state looks at for room sizes. So it won't be part of the PowerPoint, but it will be a part of the documents that the City Council receives. Sharon.
You asked about the other waivers that might be necessary, and I'm just taking out of the packets that we've been given from JCJ, is the minimum site size at 321.03, the maximum size for a school building.
We need
at
the waivers.
Mm-hmm. Are those the type of other waivers you wanted to know? Like
that's
everything
what I wanna know.
We need
I
for
know.
A waiver, period?
Yes.
And so, therefore, the artificial turf athletic field was also in this presentation for Ed 321.29.
Yeah, so what are all the waivers? That's
so
really
is
the
that
question.
The only other three besides our educational space for us, you know, inside the building? Like, are these the only other waivers that we need to build this building?
You might need one.
Because yeah. I think these are the only three I've ever seen guys list.
Again, going through, we are satisfying the requirements of the Ed 321. We can go back and verify that, but again, it's basically the size of the site. We're trying to maximize the amount of reimbursement, state aids for building size, mm-hmm. and then again, if the synthetic field is desired, that would require multiple waivers.
So just those two are the major
Correct.
Ones. It's the biggest one is the site. We need Correct. 17 acres, and we have right. six.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did you have a question, Lisa? Sorry, or a comment?
For the end, I guess.
Well, we're at the end.
Okay. Yes. Well, I just, what's not a part of this
okay.
PowerPoint, and I don't think anybody is arguing this in the community or on the City Council or certainly not on the school board, that there's just a clear and present need to get this building built. You know, that it really can't wait
right.
another year. Not only is there a question on, you know, building moratoriums for money, but the educational space we currently use does not and has not for a long time met the educational standards that we have. And we could have a whole laundry list of things to convince people that, you know, we need to do this, and the sooner we do it, the better off our students and our teachers and our community will be. And, you know, I don't know if we need to bring that up, but, you know, I certainly feel very strongly that this is a huge priority for our city that really can't wait.
I think there'll be opportunities to really to make that case, because, I mean, like I said at the very beginning, we're on two different timetables. And we have to do what we have to do to fulfill our obligation, responsibility of getting this information to the City Council for them to decide whether they want to bond it or not.
Right.
And we need to be comfortable with the numbers that we have. So even if JCJ trims off some, what they were talking about, then that's a number, even if it's 44.2, That's what we're going to have to decide upon as a board. I don't, you know, I know everybody here has talked to city councilors. I've talked to many. I'm a pretty optimistic guy about a lot of things. And that's why I asked my question earlier as to what I'm interested in hearing from our joint work session. I'm really interested in hearing some suggestions as to how we can actually do what we want to do and solve the middle school problems. There are many issues that we do with the fields that would solve other city problems, because they have money in a future CIP that you pointed out, $3 million to build fields about three years out. This would help solve, and they can take that money off the table. I mean, but I'm not convinced, I'll be honest with you, I'm not convinced the city council is going to come anywhere near what we're suggesting.
I just got to make the comment, and Lisa, I hear you, but, you know, John has had to put up with it before. With any delays on it, and I'm, as Rebecca said, she may have an issue on a site location. I cannot and will not support anywhere near this budget. I think I have had multitudes of calls from a lot of different age groups that we absolutely have our head in the sand in regards to what the city can afford, meaning the actual taxpayers. And I'll tell you right now, if the elections were municipal of the last month, anybody talking about this would have a hard time getting reelected, because 44.5 million dollars is an absolute devastation to many people in the city, and I'm hearing it left and right. And I'm going on record right here, and I'll go on record tomorrow night. I cannot support that dollar amount. It is something in my heart of hearts that I believe is devastating to the city. I was quite surprised last week there wasn't any reduction from the city council on anything. So maybe this has some legs, but I'm going to go on record now, and I'll go on record straight through that. I have a price in my head that I think is a little bit more palatable. And it's actually, I'm going to be quite honest, lower than what the mayor has said. And I just know it can be done. It can't be done maybe on that site. Maybe it can. I don't know. But I have a number that I have to live with.
Well, that's exactly the point. We all have to come to a point where we feel we have the number we can live with. Absolutely. No question about it. And I have tremendous understanding for the position the city council's in. What Kent is saying is absolutely right. I mean, I think, you know, the school board does not have control over the timing of all of these things, right? The fire station, they voted $25 million to bond the water treatment plant. I'm sure they didn't hold as many meetings as we've held with the middle school on that. They have a sewer treatment plant coming up that I hear could be as much as $50 to $60 million in the future, that 3 or 4 years out as that kind of a bond. I understand the city council is in a worse position than we are, having to make a judgment and weigh sewer versus education. I mean, it's a tough, tough choice. And you add it all up together, it's going to be $80, $90, $100 million that the city's going to have to bond, just because all of these things are coming together at once. But we still have this responsibility and obligation to do the best job we think, to come up with a proposal we think will work for the quality of the education of the kids and the school and serve the community well for the next 75 years. That's, I mean, how I view what we have to do.
Wow.
That's all really it is. I mean, and I love this conversation. This is a great quality conversation. This is the kind of conversation we just need to have with the city council, because as we get closer to the vote, it's really more heart to heart about how do we make this work. You know, I think part of my job is to help convince the council that this is the right way to go, but you know, we'll see. Okay, any other comments, closing comments? We'll see you tomorrow night. Thank you everyone for coming. JCJ, Russ.
Could I just mention that you all have the leadership profile that will be voted on tomorrow night?
I know.
So please read it.
Thank you, Ann.
Thank you.